In this video, we'll look at the different types of digesters used in AD processes. And these can be grouped based on the level of solids, so our wet, slurry, and stackable systems, the temperature that the reactor is operated at, and the number of stages of the reactor for a wet system. So to understand, starting with the number of stages, why that can be a consideration, it's important to first understand what is the actual biological reaction happening in our anaerobic digestion. So we know our overall reaction of organics to methane plus CO2, but that doesn't all happen by one microbe at once. There's a whole community of microbes in here. They work together and pass along their products until we get to all the way to the bottom. So the first thing that happens is we have these big organic molecules. Those need to get chopped up into smaller organic molecules that are more metabolizable by other bacteria. So that step is called hydrolysis. Interestingly, hydrolysis is most efficient at an acidic pH. It's also the slowest step in the process. So tackling these big complex molecules is really difficult, and it's important to try and speed up this slowest step where possible. So that's why a two-stage system can be useful for this, because you'll notice that the hydrolysis step operates best at a different pH than the other steps. The other steps work best closer to neutral, especially the last step, methanogenesis. You want neutral, and that's important for actually getting the gas. So you can't really have both of them work really well in a continuously stirred system that will be the same pH throughout. The batch processes and the plug flow processes, they don't have this issue of mixing the material together. It's aging together as it moves through the plug or as it sits there in the batch. So it doesn't need to be divided up. It's going to go through all these changes in order together. So after our hydrolytic bacteria do our hydrolysis, they break down our big molecules into simpler organics. So the big polymers would be broken down into, like, a polysaccharide would be into mono and bisaccharides, a protein would go into its amino acids, a fat would go into its fatty acids. So now these smaller molecules can be eaten up by acetogenic bacteria, which will turn them into organic acids as well as alcohols. And that's called acidogenesis. And the names are really close. And the next step after that is converting all that stuff into acetate, which is one of the universal kind of energy molecules in living organisms. So we have acetogens doing acidogenesis and then acetogens doing acetogenesis. So now we've got our complex molecules, hydrolysis, they're simple molecules, acidogenesis, they're organic acids, acetogenesis, now we've got them into acetate. And we also will produce a little bit of hydrogen and CO2 at this stage. So interesting side note, maybe in the future, we'll find a way to really maximize this hydrogen production and decarbonize our biogas. So that's an interesting prospect. But for now, we focus on converting it all into methane. So the next step is methanogenesis. And there's two groups of methanogens. So we've got our acetate, our hydrogen, and our CO2. Some methanogens can use the acetate. These are called acetoclastic methanogens. So clastic is breaking. They're breaking apart the acetate to make the biogas. And then there's hydrogenotrophic methanogens. So hydrogen-eating methanogens that use that hydrogen and CO2 that's there. But they both form the same biogas mixture of methane and CO2 at the end. So that's what's going on in a plug or a batch. All that would be happening together in the waste. In a continuously stirred wet process, you'd have material of different ages trying to go through these things at different times, which is why it might be useful to split it into two stages. The next criteria we can use for classifying reactors is based on the temperature they're operated at. So to start in the middle with the mesophilic reactors, these operate around our body temperature, so we're about 37 degrees. These reactors, one of the key advantages is it's a pretty robust microbial community that can be maintained at that temperature. And it might require a little bit of heating and insulation to keep that, but not to the extent that a thermophilic was. Now, if we go hotter into the thermophilic range, these reactors, they can be smaller because the reaction happens faster. So if you think back to first year chemistry, there's the Arrhenius equation that describes how reaction speed increases with temperature. So in an AD system, you get about a doubling of the reaction speed every time you increase the temperature 10 degrees. A side benefit is that in the thermophilic range, a lot of the pathogenic bacteria are eliminated. And this is something that happens naturally in compost. So compost will heat up to about 55 degrees Celsius. AD won't necessarily do that on its own. And that's because AD, we have less energy to work with, as we looked at before, than compost, because we don't have oxygen to give that terminal electron acceptor. So we don't get as hot. There's not as much energy being released. So for a thermophilic process, it would need to be heated and insulated, which adds to the cost. But being able to make it smaller because you're putting more throughput with the faster rate can balance that a little bit. And then at the bottom of our temperature level is our sicrophilic reactor. Now these might be more feasible in a cold climate where you'd need really a lot of insulation and heating to reach mesophilic. So there's research being done about how these could be effectively applied in Canada, especially in northern communities.